Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Mrinmoy Pramanik. I teach Comparative Indian Language and Literature at the University of Calcutta. Today we'll discuss about the Parsi theatre. The content of this module is prepared by me. For 100 years, 1850 to 1950, Parsi theatre actually dominated Indian theatrical culture. And the most creative period of Parsi theatre was between 1870 to 1890, and it brought different kind of changes in attitude and perception about theatre in the minds of the people of India. Parsis were the pioneer in modern theatre movement in India. The theatre what they had introduced is popularly known as Parsi theatre. It is beginning of a new tradition in Indian theatrical culture. Before this tradition had been started, there was different kind of folk theatre forms, performance of folk theatre forms as only one kind of Indian theatrical practice. 1850s onwards, Parsis started performing theatre following the British or European theatre in India. The first Parsi theatre company was started in 1853, and it was owned and directed by Gustadji Dalal and supported by Dadabhai Nauroji, K.R. Kama, Dr. Vanudaji, Ardeshir Moose and few others. There were many other theatre companies by the Parsis which were emerged after this. Those were the Zoroastrian Theatrical Club, the Student Amateur Club, the Victoria Natak Mandali, Natak Uttejak Company, Empress Victoria Theatrical Company and the Alfred Natak Mandali. According to Parzor and website what preserve the information and documents about Parsi theatre, according to Parzor, almost 20 drama companies were founded in between 1853 to 1869. Parsi theatre actually prepared a path for the emergence of Bhasha theatre in India. For example, it has immense influence on the growth and development of modern Gujarati theatre. What was most significant about Parsi theatre is its contribution towards stage design, use of technical apparatus, introduction of professional attitude, opera culture, etc. In other side, it appeared as alternative theatrical culture than the mainstream dominating European theatre culture what was introduced along with British conquered India. Parsi theatre companies brought confidence among modern Indian professional theatre practitioners to write drama for their own theatre also. Parsis introduced Urdu drama for performing in the theatre. This is how it prepared a road towards modern Bhasha theatre with enough boost and collective cultural confidence. Beside Urdu and Gujarati, Hindustani and English were major languages what Parsi theatre used to perform. The themes of the Parsi theatre were widely extended from Persian Shahnama to different Indian classics. This was only theatrical form as well as culture what was pan-Indian. Their troupe used to perform from northern part of India to the southern part of India, from western part of India like Gujarat to east, eastern part of India till Bengal, and it extended beyond the Indian territory because their performances used to happen till Burma. Parsi theatre had certain unique trails. Before the drama began, three actors would collectively chant a prayer. After the prayer, one actor would deliver a prologue. Music was integral part of Parsi theatre, and at the end of the play, an actor expressed thanks to the audience and often sang farewell. Humor is one of the very common and integral component in Parsi theater. The passionate lover and practitioners of Parsi theater in Kolkata, the Calcutta Parsi Amateur Dramatic Club, kept alive these songs of music in Parsi theater in their memory. Apart from these aspects and realities of Parsi theater, it should also be noted that the Parsi theater is so much into Parsi identity and rooted into Parsi culture that it is like soul of not only the community but also to the individuals who subscribe it. Parsi theater is a community culture, is a family culture, and is a romance of the individual who are or were passionate with it or about it. Times of India reported on 5th January 2016, I quote, Yazdi Karanzia, an octogenarian Surti and one of the doyens of Parsi theatre in Gujarat, was in Ahmedabad on Saturday to deliver a talk on the history of Parsi theatres, part of a three-day literary festival organized by Gujarat University. The question about survival of Parsi theatre is one of the most frequently asked questions nowadays. But I am hopeful, Karanjia said, but I am hopeful that the theatre will be alive till the last of Parsis is alive. According to Karanjia, the history of Parsi theatre in India can be traced back to 1840s when they performed Shakespeare's play and Faramzi Dalal staged very popular original Parsi play Rustam and Sohrab in 1850s. Not only in the history of Indian Bhasha theatre but also Parsi theatre had its immense influence on Bollywood movies. Ardeshir Irani, Sohrab Modi, Prithviraj Kapoor brought the tradition of theatre into cinema. Sohrab Modi's Pukar, 1939, was Parsi theatre-based Hindi movie. The influence of Parsi theatre went beyond the use of Urdu. The song and dance formula owes its popularity to the Parsi theatre to a great extent. When the Bombay film industry grew, Urdu by default became the language of cinema, commented by Parsi Kavar. The Parsi theatre took a new turn in post-independence India with the rise of the popular cinema. The standard bearers were Firoz Antia and Dr. Ratan Marshall. Adi Marzban freed Parsi drama from the shackles of traditions and brought realism to the theatre. Now let us talk about very specific things about the Parsi theatre. I begin with a quotation with basic information about Parsi theatre. A Parsi theatre employed the prevailing local languages, Gujarati, Urdu and Hindi, used the European style proscenium with a richly painted backdrop, curtains and trick stage effects, and depended on spectacle and melodrama to create audience appeal. Simultaneously, it ushered in the conventions and techniques of realism, marking the transition from stylized open-air presentation to a new urban drama. Although largely displaced by motion pictures after the advent of sound in the 1930s, Parsi theatre remains a vital component of the subcontinent's cultural heritage, significant for its long-term impact on diverse regional theatrical styles and the popular cinema. So from this quotation consisting with very basic information about Parsi theatre, we came to know that Parsi theatre by nature is very much cross-cultural, and it has a several kind of influence in Indian professional theatre, in the drama writing, in Indian Bhasha literature, and to shape the pattern of dialogues and design of Bollywood movies. One can be amazed to see the kind of sophistication found in the different companies' production of Parsi theater. They used to have a proscenium seating, proscenium arc, rose high above the stage, positioning the players with an expansive picture frame and separating them from the audience. Massive painted curtains sets the shifted between the scenes, and lavish costumes created a sumptuous atmosphere filled with exotic images. Gas lights placed on the apron of the stage light, the players from below accentuating their gestures in an uncanny way. Sets arranged by class and row announced times for starting and stopping, and amenities such as refreshments rooms and intervals added a sense of decorum to the proceedings in the hall. Family shows where special performances for women were also a feature of the Parsi theater's popularity and growing respectability of the middle classes. Playhouse were set up to the children, tended by their ayahs. Now, from this description of Parsi theater, we understand that in the 19th century or in the beginning of 20th century, when women education was so restricted, women freedom was hardly given to the women. It was so restricted. The Parsi theater offered us different kind of space for the women, and definitely it helped women to be enriched. Definitely it educated women's, even it educated the teenagers and the children who used to go to watch Parsi theater. Parsi theater went into phase of professionalism in 1870s, and as a result they took actors and actresses from the lower class. And their target audience was from middle classes as well as the upper class. So its approach went beyond the class restrictions. Across the class, Parsi theater has its influence. Kabazji Khatu, Jehangir Kambatta, and other actors are known to have lived in the narrow lens of Dhobi Talao, a poor district centrally located in the city Bombay. The Natak Uttejak Mandali staged 1,100 shows over 16 years. Initially, Parsis who took a lead in this movement were educated people, guided by a desire to contribute towards the betterment of the society. They viewed theatre as a medium through which they could communicate with the ordinary people. The theater that arose out of these motivations had themes that carried moral and social messages for the audience. Sometimes these theater groups were patronized by the upper class, but their audience was middle class, their actors were from lower class, and they had approach of education irrespective of gender and age. They were successfully able to bring women, older people, and the children together in the theater hall. And most significant thing about Parsi theater is it was not only restricted in the proscenium or the closed door hall, but they reached to the people of different places in India and even outside India, as I mentioned about Burma. Now let us talk about multilingual sources of Parsi theater. As we mentioned earlier, that Parsi theater adapted languages like Urdu, Gujarati, Hindi, and English. And its very beginning, Parsi theater used to perform Shakespeare plays written by Shakespeare. Shakespeare was performed in 19th century in European proscenium theatres and also the Persian theatres. And later on, Parsi theatre adapted stories from Persian roots and many other Indian bhasha culture. And this is how bhasha culture got a confidence and its prestige to be performed on the stage of professional proscenium theatre. The first Urdu book to feed the Parsi theatre was Natak Sagar by Noor Ilahi and Muhammad Umar, published in 1924. The Urdu, which was used in different productions of Parsi theatre, was not only the Urdu of Delhi or Lucknow, but the Urdu mixed with Gujarati, Hindi and Awadhi. This is how different registers of the language were used in the Parsi theatre. Each dramatic text became multilingual, what successfully broke the barrier of languages. And these multilingual text actually holds the ethos of multilingual nature and character of India. It reflected the multilingual nature and character of India. This is how small text of Parsi theatre actually unfolded in with the significance of multilingualism in Indian context. Moreover, this Parsi theatre text gave confidence to different dialects, different registers, that none of the registers or dialects of a language is marginal or neglectable. All these languages or registers are language of art, language of culture. Parsi theatre actually performed it. Not only believed, but performed it. This is about the Urdu sources of Parsi theatre. Now let us talk about the Gujarati sources of Parsi theatre and the very integrity between Parsi theatre and Gujarati language. I quote, "The most important among the Gujarati weeklies was Kaisari Hind, established in 1882. Essays by Dhanjibhai and Patel, 1857 to 1937, on the Parsi theatre were published serially in it for 97 weeks. Of these, 68 were collected and published as Parsi Natak Takhtani Tavarik by Kayar, Kayari Hind Press, in 1931. The book included approximately 150 photographs of Parsi actors. Patton's narrative extends from the founding of the Parsi Natak Mandal in 1853 through the era of Mary Fenton and covers Khatau in 1890s. There is very significant contribution of Parsi theatre in stagecraft. They alternatively used shwalo and deep scenes as their stagecraft in theatre, and the shwalo scenes were played in the foreground of the stage with a painted curtain, normally depicting a street as a backdrop. These scenes were reserved for the lower class characters with prominence given to comedy. They served as the link scenes in the development of the plot, but the main purpose was to keep the audience engaged with the deep scenes, which showed interior of palaces, royal parks and other such visually opulent sets were being changed or decorated. The important characters rarely appeared in the street scenes, and in the deep scenes, the lower classes strictly kept their place." I unquote. So through these two above statements, one is regarding the Gujarati source of Parsi theatre, we can find the documentation, whole process of research and documentation, what happened in Gujarati language by the great scholar Patel to keep a record, keep document of Parsi theatre. And it is one of the significant research happened on Indian theater, 19th century and early 20th century Indian theater. So in that case, this work by Patel offered a discursive framework and methodology to keep record of this old theatrical form. And this is how the Gujarati connection of Parsi theater actually is very much important, not only to find the history of Parsi theater, or not only to find the history of Gujarati theater, or the history of connections between Gujarati or Parsi theater, but also to find the process of documentation and research what happened in Gujarati language about Parsi theater. The second statement, which is about the stagecraft of Parsi theater, shows that how the production manager, director, and the whole scholars and the thinkers who were behind this production of Parsi theater were conscious, very conscious about the class division of the society, and how they represented the class divisions very consciously in their theatrical forms, in their theater production. Now let us talk about Parsi theater as secular space. As I mentioned, that Parsi theater used to have their language as like Urdu language, Hindi, Gujarati, and Hindi and English language for theater performance. We can find that Parsi theater tried to offer very secular space, or tried to accommodate varieties in their production. Girish Karnad, in his Theatre in India, commented, I quote, "The play dealt with subjects ranging from Middle Eastern romances to Hindu myths and the adaptations of Shakespeare, but the treatment avoids all religious and ethical nuances. Secularism was a fashionable concept." As the audience was heterogeneous across the classes, castes, and religious communities, they were catered different narrative genres. Sometimes it was Indo-Muslim fairy romance, sometimes Hindu mythology, and sometimes bourgeois social drama. This is how whole approach of Parsi theater was very much inclusive, and it held polyphony and plurality of Indian culture through the practice. In Parsi theater, we can find different versions of Mahabharata and Ramayana. They also used to perform Mahabharata and Ramayana, and they use actresses like Gohar and Mary Fenton, Muslim and Anglo-Indian respectively, and they played a role of Sita and other heroines, while Parsi and Muslim men played the parts of Rama and Krishna. The glory of Hindu mythic figures had been a mainstay of Parsi theater since the Indra Sabha arrived in Bombay from post-mutiny Lucknow. The heteroglossia of Indra Sabha was mirrored in countless dramatic texts of period. So this is how we can find that not only the languages but also the contents were very much diverse, and contents were taken from different sources to put a ethos of secularism through their production. Parsi theater had immense influence or immense role to play in the freedom movement and the religious harmony. The Nataka Mandali not only inspired Indian Bhasha theatre movement, but also it had impressive contribution in the freedom movement, as they used to perform nationalist and socially realist dramas in their theatre. I quote, "In its remarkable century-long history, traversing the colonial and nationalist eras, the Parsi theatre was unique as a site of communal harmony. The Parsi theatre began in Bombay in the early 1850s and fanned out across South and Southeast Asia by the 1880s. During the 20th century, major Parsi theatrical companies flourished in Lahore, Delhi, and Calcutta, exerting a huge impact on the development of modern drama, regional music, and the cinema. Parsis, Hindus, Muslims, Anglo-Indians, and Baghdadi Jews consulted amicably in both residential and traveling companies. Although company ownership usually remained in Parsi hands, actors were drawn from many communities, as were professional writers, musicians, painters, stagehands, and other personnel. I unquote. So, Parsi theatre became a place of different kind of people. People from different class, caste, region, language, religion, and people from different talents actually gathered to produce a text of Parsi theatre. We can find in the history of Indian modern Indian theatre, we can observe decline of Parsi theatre after independence. As the majority of Parsi playwright went into a kind of hibernation, the independence made Parsi community very much confused, because before independence, during independence and after independence, India observed a religious conflict between Hindu and Muslims. The partition happened in Punjab and Bengal. So there were so much religious riots, conflicts and problems. What actually disturbed the psychology of the theatrical or the theater personalities of Parsi. And this nation was not only divided physically, but was divided psychologically also. And because of this, the Parsi theater became very much confused that what to cater, whom to cater, and how to cater. This peace-loving community did not know whom to affiliate with. And this psychological crisis, the crisis of non-alliance, made one of the major reasons of decline of Parsi theatre. The silence of the Parsis, what we found in the Parsi, with the decline of Parsi theatre, actually broke during 1970s and 1980s, when writers like Rohinton Mistry, Firdous Kanga, Dina Mehta, and Thriti Umrigar and Boman Desai came. The writings in the text of these writers displayed ethno-religious attributes. There was feeling of alienation and insecurity experienced by diasporic communities. Now let us conclude our discussion. Parsi theatre is first Indian professional theatre in modern times. It had pan-Indian influence, and it could successfully transcend the barrier of caste, community and language along with the geographic boundaries. The very Indian favor of multilingualism was truly practiced in this theater culture. It was beginning of Indian awakening towards confidence to own a theater tradition professionally and to practice theatrical forms found in different Indian Bhasha traditions. Parsi theater was so powerful in its approach through content, style, language and mobility that it had influenced the audience of urban India, mainly across the geography. This theatrical tradition can be strongly observed as continuous flow of alternative aesthetics in British India. Parsi theater successfully defined or offered a definition to an Indian style of expression, and because of this powerful contribution, later Bombay movie adapted Parsi theatre style in it. Overwhelming cultural reception and its power to become a cultural denominator because of having pan-Indian audience in British India, it can claim itself as first people's theatre in modern India, bringing the people from different class, genders and ages, from different linguistic, cultural and ethnic community is truly historic. But it is not the case that the Parsi theatre did not observe any rejection from the people. Renowned Bharatendu Harishchandra, a famous poet and critic in Hindi, was not ready to accept this theatre. Now I would like to finish this conclusion by a comment made by Katharina Hansen. She commented, Katharina Hansen commented, although the Parsi theater was produced within a cosmopolitan entertainment economy at a time when linguistic and communal identities were fluid and overlapping, the knowledge of the Parsi theater disseminated through South Asian language-based scholarly traditions has been produced under the shadow of the subcontinent's religious and ethnic antagonisms. Thank you.